Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Life Lessons from a Parasite: What Tapeworms, Flukes, Lice, and Roundworms Can Teach Us About Humanity's Most Difficult Problems. By John Janovy, Jr. Read by Joel Richards. Introduction. A World of Infection. Your oldest child comes home from school with head lice, along with a note that they can't return until the lice are gone. After the screaming subsides, your trip to Google turns up some options, including shampoos, combing, Vaseline, mayonnaise, and an insecticide, pyrethrin, derived from chrysanthemum flowers, or permethrin, the synthetic version of it, recommended by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. But then there's the problem of lice eggs, or nits, still stuck to hairs and pillowcases. If you're a fan of ancient history, you now have an opportunity to comb through your child's hair and go nitpicking, just like early humans did and chimpanzees still do. Regardless of how you handle this situation, you'll come away educated about parasites, species that must live in or on other unrelated species to survive, and parasitism, the most common way of life among animals on Earth. That education, delivered by lice, should be useful when your other child comes home from daycare with pinworms, or from high school infected with bad ideas. Parasites are organisms that live in close, even intimate and obligate relationships with unrelated species, their hosts. That relationship is both physical and physiological, involving parasite use of host tissues and substances such as sugars and amino acids. Furthermore, parasites cannot survive without this relationship. Why do we believe that parasitism is the most common way of life among animals on Earth? The answer is simple. Every species that has been studied carefully has been shown to be infected with several different kinds of worms, lice, ticks, mites, and single-celled organisms known as protists, all in addition to bacteria, fungi, and viruses. For example, at least 40 different kinds of parasites, tapeworms, roundworms, lice, and so on, have been reported living in and on the robins that show up in North American backyards. Similar claims can be made for all familiar birds. But even the insects in your garden and earthworms down in the soil have parasites. How do those animals get infected? That's the same question you'll ask about your children with head lice and pinworms. That's the same question you'll ask when your children are older and get infected with ideas that change their behavior and are not consistent with your dreams for their futures. That's the same question the world has been asking while a virus sweeps across continents, leaving a trail of ignorance and death in its wake. This book is also about scientists who spend their lives trying to answer questions of transmission, in the process, learning important lessons from the parasites they study, lessons applicable far beyond the field of parasitology. These scientists are captivated by what they find when they cut up some animal and start digging through its guts. Although their immediate interests usually concern how these animal parasites are sustained in nature, it doesn't take much of this research before a person starts making a connection between parasitic worms and parasitic ideas. So this book is also about what the study of parasitism does to scientists' minds, especially their thoughts about all kinds of infective cultural phenomena, including memes, fake news, conspiracy theories, and weapons, to name a few. Anyone who's studied parasites of any kind sees a common thread among things that move through populations. Infectivity is a property that is possessed or can be acquired by almost anything we humans can discover or make, including our pictures, stories, music, machines, and words, all in addition to those viruses, bacteria, fungi, and non-human animals that can, and so often do, make our bodies their homes. This book is my attempt to lead you to the same conclusion, not only by letting you share the experiences of some chosen parasitologists, but also by proposing a general theory of infectivity that applies to whatever we encounter during our lives. But to really understand this ubiquitous way of life, one needs to collect animals, look through their bodies for the other animals living there, and pay attention to what those parasites are telling us about how they live and prosper. Unfortunately for those host animals we're taking lessons from, they usually must be captured and killed, sometimes in large numbers, before we can draw conclusions about the lives of infectious agents, especially in populations. Once during a bar conversation over beers with some young scientists, we tried to estimate the numbers of wild animals that we'd collected while searching for parasites. At the time, I was a senior citizen, but my colleagues were in their late 20s or early 30s, pursuing advanced degrees in biology. Although their time for exploring the natural world was less than mine, a couple of them had done far more collecting, and subsequently dissecting, than I could account for personally, because they were studying nature in a manner that required hundreds of specimens to satisfy statistical requirements. What were these studies? They were ones that focused on the way these infectious organisms developed and were transmitted from one host animal to another, spreading through an ecosystem. Whether they realized it or not, these young scientists were preparing themselves to understand global pandemics, evaluate political response to epidemic disease, and serve as teachers dedicated to shutting down a pathogen's opportunities for infection. In the process, they'd come to view living organisms not as individuals or even species, but as communities. If you're a parasitologist on a downtown street corner, for example, and across the street are others waiting for a green light to cross safely, what do you see? You see members of our human species, a few examples of the nearly 8 billion other people who now occupy planet Earth, and collectively provide a nutritious environment for at least 250 different, yes, different kinds of other animals. Parasitic worms, lice, mites, and their ilk, all in addition to viruses, bacteria, fungi, and got it from my friend ideas about treatment of diseases like COVID-19. Are these parasites thriving in the people you now see walking toward you? Maybe. But probably not if you're in some place like Omaha, Nebraska. Because of their location and good fortune, these folks are walking examples of the first rule of infectious disease transmission. Standard of living matters. Functional sewage systems, window screens to keep out the mosquitoes, shoes to stop hookworm juveniles from burrowing into the skin between your toes, water treatment plants that eliminate cysts and spores, and affordable health care are all manifestations of a relatively high standard of living. But standard of living also includes an educational system that provides skills needed to sort valid information from outright lies, outlandish claims, and conspiracy theories that populate social media and move through nations as easily as a pandemic virus. This book is my attempt to add that last skill to your standard of living. Most of the material in the following chapters is derived from my research activities as a biological scientist over a 50-year period, which in turn rested on a childhood spent studying nature as a hunter, trapper, fisherman, and addicted reader of hunting and fishing magazines, books about firearms, and adventure fiction such as the now politically incorrect Bomba the Jungle Boy series. That behavior was aided and abetted by a father and paternal grandfather, the former with gear and what seems in retrospect to have been an obligation to teach his son to hunt and fish, and the latter with stories of wild early 20th century life on the American Great Plains. Conversation in our home was mostly about literature, nature, geology, music, and global affairs. Thus, looking back on the 60 years since I made the decision to be a professional biologist, that Oklahoma childhood played out on the edge of town, often with a fishing pole or shotgun in hand, seems to have been a preview of what I would learn about animals as a scientist. Life Lessons from a Parasite is my attempt to describe that revelation and arrive at an attempt to answer the question of what it means to be a human with power to wreak havoc on other living organisms, including our fellow humans. One of the first lessons I learned from studying parasites is that our personal reaction to collecting wild animals, an act that enables us to look for worms within the victim's bodies, depends on a number of factors, including who or what is being killed, where it is being killed, why it is being killed, how it is being killed, and who is doing the collecting. In writing this book, I've tried to address these questions of who, what, why, when, where, and how, and to address them in a way that leads naturally to the question of what we, as human beings, do to build and sustain an individual, national, ethnic, or religious identity. I contend that giving some serious thought to why, when, where, and how I might disassemble a beetle or a small fish leads inevitably toward serious thoughts about why my fellow humans behave as they do, especially with regard to the taking of lives. Something happens to generate this comparison, something worth writing about, talking about, and thinking about daily. That something is part of what makes us Homo sapiens, and it's also why I'm writing this book about the collection of animals and the rationale behind such collecting, namely in an attempt to satisfy our curiosity about parasites and parasitism, eventually including infection with dangerous ideas. The first few chapters include stories of people studying the lives of parasites, that is, being parasite hunters, mostly in the North American Great Plains. I've tried to bring you into their worlds and into mine as we collected animals and extracted the other kinds of animals living in and on the ones we'd collected. I've also tried to engage you in the driving curiosity about parasitism that in turn drives parasite hunters' actions. Throughout those chapters, I've tried to lead you intellectually into the kinds of thoughts and conversations this research produces in its practitioners. Thoughts and conversations about larger questions, such as why we are so vulnerable to infection with dangerous ideas, especially ones that spawn hate and violence. In later chapters, I've tried to elaborate on aspects of science that are rarely, if ever, dealt with in either popular or scientific literature, namely that realm of work never published, but that nevertheless has a powerful impact on the thinking of those involved in doing it or watching it being done. Thinking that leads naturally to long discussions about the nature of science and especially the influence that investigation of the natural world has on the people doing it. Parasitology is a rich, challenging, and often inaccessible discipline practiced by those who are not afraid of its mysteries and potential failures. As a University of Toronto biochemist once remarked in a speech honoring the retirement of a colleague, a distinguished and well-known parasitologist, "Parasitology, queen of biology, one part of science to two of mythology." Those of us who practice it understand. Thus, those later chapters are my attempt to engage you in the kind of mental extensions that come from a lifetime spent studying infectious organisms and living professionally with others trying to do the same. Very few of the parasites introduced in this book are infectious to humans or our domestic animals. I've never been a scientist for the self-proclaimed purpose of curing humanity of its burdens, so you're not going to hear very much about deadly disease or terror in your drinking water. Instead, all this collecting, dissecting, and subsequent lab work rests on the well-known fact that parasitism is the most common way of life among animals on Earth, and on curiosity about how those parasites survive in nature. If parasitism is the most common way of life, goes the reasoning, it should be found everywhere, in abundance and diversity, and its various ways of managing existence, along with the accompanying lessons, should lead us naturally to questions about ourselves. John Janovy, Jr. Chapter 1. Why Parasites? Nature ignores your desires. Find the parasite first, and everything else will fall in place. Gerald W. Esch, Parasites, People, and Places, Essays on Field Parasitology, 2004. Parasitology is the study of how and why an organism's body can become occupied by another, unrelated organism. Parasitologists tend to focus on this relationship between host and parasite. We try to determine how that relationship is maintained, how a parasite gains access to a host, and whether the host has defense mechanisms to help protect it from invasion. We also ask the evolutionary questions of why this relationship was formed in the ancient past, and what host species are now occupied by a parasite's relatives. By trying to discover not only how and why one species comes to live in or on the body of another, but also how these parasites move through populations of hosts, we learn lessons that are not confined to the host and parasite. We can apply these lessons to animal life in nature, human life in society, ourselves, and problems far more serious than, for example, a mysterious worm inside a fish in an Oklahoma lake. Complex life histories are the main reason why parasitology is such an educational discipline. Many parasites have what are called indirect life cycles, because to develop into an infective stage, they must spend time inside more than one host. A parasitic worm's eggs can hatch into larvae that develop only to a certain point in one host species, which then must be eaten by another host species before the worm can develop further to become infective for the next host, and so on. To understand how such parasites are maintained in nature, we must study all these life cycle stages, including their ecology and evolutionary history. This homework turns parasitologists into broadly educated people. It also, however, tends to guide their research by making them expect certain events to happen in nature and giving them hope they can replicate those events in the lab. Scientists who study parasite transmission also come to view all things that move through populations as infective agents carried by hosts. Hands-on experience with worms that live inside other animals and have complex life cycles teaches us to study every possible avenue for parasite transmission. Eventually, we learn that infected hosts can carry everything from viruses to fleas to lice and worms, as well as ideas that alter human behavior. For this reason, parasitologists are altered by their research. But that fate of being shaped by the work you do is not exclusive to parasitologists or scientists in general, or to the rest of us, regardless of our chosen trades or professions. Artists are created in large part by what they learn from their art, musicians from the lessons their music teaches them, and athletes from the way their games are played. But only parasitologists spend their days studying the most common way of life among animals on Earth. So it's not surprising that they end up with a diverse repertoire of life lessons, including ones taught by worms that defy scientists' best efforts to explain their existence. The following passages tell a story in which these expectations were never met, with constant failure delivering an important lesson about nature and about ourselves. The scientists involved finally had to admit that what seemed like a simple problem in the beginning turned out to be a monumental mystery that no amount of effort was able to solve. This problem is a seemingly simple one. A species, known as buffalo fish, lives in an Oklahoma lake and has strange worms in its ovaries. A scientist wants to discover how those worms got there. He doesn't want to cure the buffalo fish of this infection or make you believe he can do that. He's just captivated by the odd structure of these worms and their unusual location, a fish's ovaries. The worm is not infective to humans, so it poses no health problem to people who might eat the fish or inadvertently gulp down the water while swimming in the lake. The problem worm has a scientific name, Nematobothrium texamensis, which, like any of the hot-button words that show up in daily headlines, such as immigration and climate change, hides a complex problem. Yet the issues defined by these words end up being portrayed in simple terms, especially by elected officials with agendas. These words are also examples of infective agents, but ones with all the personal, social, and economic conditions they contain hidden in and carried by language instead of in a fish that has parasites packed away in its ovaries. This worm story takes place mostly in southern Oklahoma. Denison Dam connects Oklahoma and Texas, from north to south, respectively, and blocks the appropriately named Red River, producing one of the world's most ramified freshwater bodies, Lake Texoma. Home of this parasitic worm that so far has defied everyone's efforts to explain its existence, Lake Texoma spreads into the northern Texas and southern Oklahoma valleys west of Denison Dam, providing a recreational bonanza. Its 140 square miles of open water are surrounded by places like the Chickasaw Point Golf Course, the Road's End Public Use Area, and the Hook, Wine, and Sinker Bar. Beneath that open water surface, which is often wind-whipped to a fury that keeps sailors hunkered down over their beer, swim buffalo fish, so named because their profile reminds us of the iconic American bison. And within those buffalo fish lives this strange worm, so structurally different from its relatives, occupying the fish's ovaries instead of an intestine, and disintegrating to release its eggs instead of just releasing them from a uterus. The scientists who tried but failed to solve the mystery of its existence, how it gets from fish to fish, are all dead, but the worm remains. Thus we have the first of many life lessons taught by parasites. Seemingly simple problems can have solutions that elude the finest minds. That this lesson involved a parasitic worm in a fish makes it seem almost inconsequential compared to the other problems scattered across our daily newsfeed. But just like the rest of us have failed to solve those larger and much more consequential problems, the scientists obsessed with this worm failed to discover how it was transmitted through the fish population that allowed it to survive in the depths of Lake Texoma. Their years spent trying, however, using every means at their disposal, taught them this lesson in a way they'd never have truly appreciated just from reading about those larger problems. This parasitic worm resembles a nearly microscopic thread in the buffalo fish's ovaries. The fish routinely spawn and reproduce. There is no evidence that the worm damages its host. The scientific literature, playing an authority role, seems to suggest how this parasite lived in nature, how it developed, and became infective to the next fish. So the scientists, trying to solve the problem of transmission, trusted the literature and used it as a guide to design their studies. That literature led them astray, not unlike what has happened before in medical research. From such leading comes another lesson taught by a parasite, and applicable perhaps to the words climate change. What happens in the natural world has no necessary connection to your beliefs, your desires, or what others have said. That lesson applies even when we contribute to the natural world's condition, for example, by burning fossil fuels or by destroying tropical forests at a hellish rate. This recalcitrant worm is a fluke that does not match our perception of either its structure or its life in the wild. The parasites we call flukes are flatworms. They generally range in size from near microscopic to an inch or so in length, and their flattened shape makes many of them resemble leaves. Adult flukes typically have both male and female reproductive systems in a single individual. Cross-fertilization is evidently an advantage when your egg's embryonic development depends on encountering and then occupying a sequence of specific living environments: mollusks, crustaceans, aquatic insects, other fish that serve as intermediate hosts, and when the chances of such encounters are near zero for any single egg. Parasitic worms are notorious reproductive machines, spewing vast numbers of eggs into the water or on land, depending on where their host lives, usually by way of the host animal's feces. The Lake Texoma worm differed from expectations, however, by releasing its eggs through a female fish's ovarian ducts, and only at spawning time. That difference should have been a warning to the scientists investigating it. Expectations can hinder the search for the truth. In the summer of 1961, Dr. John Teague Self, known to his professional associates as Teague and to everyone else as Dr. Self, was a bear of a man, both physically and mentally. When ensconced behind his desk on the second floor of Richards Hall at the University of Oklahoma, he lowered his head and stared at you evenly over his glasses, if you had the courage to come to his office. At social gatherings, we students would mimic his trademark over-the-glasses stare. Among the graduate students who gathered at Across the Street, one of the finer college town bars in Norman, Oklahoma, to review their week's successes and failures, someone would inevitably mention this buffalo fishworm, which Self had discovered and whose existence defied explanation because he could not discover its method of transmission. The across-the-street crowd included those who had not been sucked into Self's obsession with N. texamensis, so they were happily drinking beer on a Friday afternoon instead of setting nets in Lake Texoma. Yet they still wondered how this parasite could have such a powerful effect on a person's mind, his curiosity driving him even in the face of failure. That power may have been derived from the fact that everything about N. texamensis violated the textbook picture of Flukes. This worm was 12 feet long, thin as a pencil lead, and lived in the ovaries of Lake Texoma buffalo fish. It matured only at certain times of the year, when the fish were spawning and their ovaries were filled with eggs. As the fish shed its eggs, the worm died and disintegrated, and its pieces, containing infective worm eggs, were spread out into the lake. All this worm's relatives live in ocean fish, but N. texamensis occupies a freshwater fish with no direct link to the ocean. Its habitat in the ovaries is unusual. Its disintegration as a means of shedding eggs is unique, and its thread-like structure is uncharacteristic of Flukes. The mystery fueled Self's obsession. The worm drove him to do years of research, infecting his mind with the idea that with enough effort, he could solve this problem. But among scientists who study parasites, that's a fairly common occurrence. The N. texamensis story is told officially in a few papers published in the scientific literature, including the Journal of Parasitology. But the unofficial story is written in a small field diary from the early 1960s, filled with Self's characteristic cursive. I've borrowed this field notebook from the archives of the University of Nebraska State Museum, which houses a research collection of parasites of global importance. The curator, Dr. Scott Gardner, refers to Self's diary as the Codex, and writes out a legal notice confirming that I have taken this book from fire-resistant metal cabinets that house other irreplaceable treasures. That notice is a warning. Treat this field notebook as if it is an original copy of the Declaration of Independence. Like the authors of that declaration, most, if not all, the people who penned entries into Self's Codex are dead. The others, who I believe might still be living and tried to contact, never responded. Eventually, I decided they were embarrassed at having been captured by the idea of this worm and refused to admit it. But there are long sections of handwriting other than Self's in this small brown K&E Surveyor's Field Book. And after reading through some of it, I discover the initials C.E.D., for Clarence Edgar Davis, a research assistant on the N. texamensis project, at the time funded by the National Science Foundation, that is, with government money. Davis's writing in this notebook is that of a mature scientist, careful, detailed, legible, in permanent ink and perfect grammar, and initialed CED after each entry. I can almost hear him thinking as he makes those entries, probably at night after a long day of collecting and dissecting fish. He knows someone else will be reading his notes. He doesn't know a person will be holding that little book half a century later and wondering how in the living hell anyone as smart as all these people, including the anonymous reviewers who delivered that money for self to spend on this project, could get caught up in the life of this seemingly unimportant worm that causes no damage to humans. But in 1960, N. texomensis was of serious importance to at least two humans, J. Teague Self and Clarence Edgar Davis. At the time I knew him, I believed that Clarence Davis was Self's graduate advisee as well as research assistant on the N. texomensis project, and that he must have been on leave from his faculty position at Southern University in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, a historically black institution, to pursue his doctorate. Davis's work required that he drive a state-owned vehicle alone to Lake Texoma, set gill nets, collect buffalo fish, handle them in a specified way, and otherwise do the work of a young scientist. Only in retrospect do I have a sense of what kind of courage and social skill were required for him to do what Self expected him to do, given that the setting was rural southern Oklahoma in the late 1950s and early 1960s. I remember standing in the main Oklahoma City library stacks on May 17, 1954, reading a book, when a perfect stranger came up and started shaking my arm, telling me in vulgar racist language how different my life would be now that the Supreme Court had let little Linda Brown into the elementary school closest to where she lived. That's the cultural landscape that Davis had to negotiate to do his research, do his job, and satisfy the curiosity he had about the life of worms in fish. Nowadays, the national news is a constant reminder that the challenges Davis faced trying to do his scientific work in that 1950s cultural landscape have not disappeared. During the time this book was written, media reports of racially charged language by elected officials were a regular occurrence, as were voter suppression tactics aimed at reducing participation of minorities in our nation's democratic processes. The current proliferation of weapons and the readiness with which some of us use them to counter threats, such as a child asking for directions, suggests that Davis would be putting his life in danger every time he got into a state-owned vehicle alone and headed south out of Norman, away from the relative safety of a college campus, just to collect fish and look for worms in the ovaries. Had I known then what I know now about the evolution of my nation, I'd have asked Davis if I could ride along on one of his trips to set gill nets, curtains of death that hang down from a float line into the murky waters of Lake Texoma. Fish that swim into these nets get trapped because once their front end goes through one of the square openings, their gill covers expand, get caught on the fine filaments from which these nets are made, and prevent the fish from backing out. Setting those nets and retrieving them is major physical labor, done from an aluminum boat made for two people. The goal is to have a dozen or so large fish upon retrieval, and each fish represents at least an hour, maybe two, of processing. But at the time, I believed Clarence Davis was just another grad student. In my mind, he was working on N. texomensis. Our projects become our identities. That fact has not changed in the decades since I met Self. My own use of gill nets helps me imagine the scientific part of Davis's travels half a century later. On a fall afternoon, he leaves the University of Oklahoma Biological Station, UOBS building, crosses a gravel drive, and walks down a path to the UOBS boathouse. He fires up a boat engine and breathes in the exhaust that reminds him of where he is, what he'll be doing for the next couple of hours, and most importantly, why he's doing it. Davis smiles, alone on the water, knowing that along with Self, he's caught in the intellectual net that N. Texomensis has spread, waiting for curious humans to swim up and encounter the mystery. Out in the lake arm known as Buncombe Creek, he cuts the engine to idle and reaches into the tub where his net lies perfectly coiled from the last time he used it. Half a concrete block is tied to a bottom line. He drops the block into Lake Texoma, then picks up the float made from a plastic jug and drops it over the side too. He shifts into reverse and backs up slowly, letting the net play out, its top held up by floats, its bottom sinking down 8 feet, pulled by a leaded line, spreading this curtain of death 100 yards across Lake Texoma. While I can envision his scientific activity, I have no idea what Davis does for dinner, or what happens when he tries to buy gasoline for his state-owned vehicle. The nearest town is Kingston, Oklahoma. Even had I been with him, he may not have been able to go into a cafe with me there, or get served if he did. Maybe he's brought along groceries that don't need to be cooked, peanut butter and bread, Vienna sausages, and a jug of water from Norman, where water doesn't taste like southern Oklahoma gypsum. Nothing in my experience lets me envision what he does when he's not catching and dissecting fish. The only thing I can share with Clarence Davis is the reason he's chasing this worm. Curiosity drives us, and nature provides an opportunity to study the object of that curiosity and convert our observations into scientific facts. Out on the lake the next morning, Davis slowly pulls in the net, removing the fish and tossing some of them into a bucket. He'll dissect the 4 bigmouth buffalo he's caught, Ichthyobis cyprinellus, for worms. He saves the 4-pound channel cat. He'll clean it, put the meat in a lab freezer, and live off it for a week back in Norman. A couple of crappies get tossed back into Lake Texoma. One of the crappies floats, dead. Collateral damage and snapping turtle food. Back in the dorm building, he goes into a lab and starts on his first fish. It's still alive, wet, slippery with mucus, and flipping, 2.5 pounds of live animal. He picks it up with both hands, his left thumb in the fish's mouth, while his left hand fingers make a fist under the throat. His right hand picks up a pair of heavy stainless steel scissors with short, stocky blades and long handles to provide leverage, and slips one of the blades into the upper gill chamber before pushing with all his might, crushing the backbone behind the head. That cracking sound is a familiar one that he remembers from the first time he dissected one of these fish. And it's the quickest, thus most merciful way, to kill a large fish. The body still flips. Fish nervous systems are not as centralized as those of mice. After a few seconds, the movement stops. Davis pushes one scissor's blade into the anus and starts cutting forward up to the gill chamber. He spreads the cut open, revealing all the internal organs, an anatomy lesson that he's learned well. Gravid female, ovaries bulging with eggs. He clips off the ovaries and moves them to separate petri dishes. Whatever else the fish may have been, whatever role she may have played in Lake Texoma, is erased. This female buffalo fish is now 2 ovaries in petri dishes. Now Clarence Davis is asking the same questions everyone who has ever studied parasites has asked. Are there worms in there? And if so, how did they get there? Those questions are dangerous. They can produce an all-consuming struggle with some wild mystery that Mother Nature divulges only grudgingly, if at all, as self's experience demonstrates. But those questions are the same ones raised by any problem with infectious agents, be they worms or memes. Only the methods for answering those questions differ, and the people who study the latter are more likely to be historians or marketing gurus than parasitologists. How does something get somewhere you never expect it to be? How does someone achieve success against all odds and against your expectations, given their origins, constraints, and opportunities. Although research on worms, such as N. texomensis, can easily be ridiculed, why the hell are they wasting their time and my tax money on that? The simple truth is that such research accomplishes two things of importance to a nation heavily dependent on science and technology. First, it demonstrates that a scientist can do the fundamental behavior of science successfully, develop testable hypotheses, assemble the resources necessary to test them, and bring a project to closure with publication after peer review. In the opening years of the Common Era's third millennium, the United States is in desperate need of a massive supply of such human resources, and the kind of rationale they bring to the dialogue about our nation's problems, especially during a viral pandemic. Davis's encounter with N. texomensis functioned in that expected manner, providing him with insight that would be passed on to his students for the rest of his career. The second thing academic research accomplishes is that it keeps faculty brains in shape. Faculty brains are the most valuable and costly resources of American higher education, the enterprise that produces the nation's engineers, physicians and other healthcare professionals, attorneys, public school teachers, and accountants, to name just a few. If you were ever inclined to assign power to a worm, N. texomensis would be a candidate for champion scientist trainer, the intellectual equivalent of a multi-million-dollar football coach. The main difference between the two is that if the coach wins enough games, he gets a big raise. But when a worm wins, that only deepens its allure, in essence infecting a scientist with an obsession. In their first published report about the worm, Self and a colleague, Alan McIntosh, a Federal Department of Agriculture scientist, described it as so delicate that it could not be recovered in one piece. By putting two specimens' pieces together, the scientists concluded that they were about 8 feet long and 1 millimeter, 4/100ths of an inch, wide. They could distinguish internal anatomy features, which then allowed them to figure out what general group of worms it belonged to. The Flukes, known officially as Trematoda. They were also the first ever to describe it in the scientific literature. This physical description was striking for a fluke. Imagine that you had personally handled 3,000 different kinds of flukes from 1,000 different kinds of animals, and all of them were flat, no more than an inch long, and mostly a quarter to a half inch wide. Now, from a buffalo fish, here is a worm 8 feet long and only as thick as a piece of string. And instead of living in a host's intestine and constantly spewing eggs by the thousands like most flukes, this one lives in a host's ovaries and releases its eggs only when it dies and breaks apart and the fish spawns, shedding its ovarian contents. Everything about this worm violated expectations, compounding the mystery of its existence. Although Self and McIntosh published the original species description, much of the difficult fish collection and dissection work was performed by Clarence Davis. Bigmouth buffalo fish can live for 100 years, reach 4 feet in length, and weigh 80 pounds, although the ones from Lake Texoma were generally about 2 feet long and 4 or 5 pounds. Dissection of a single infected fish could easily take an hour because of the worm's delicacy and the care required to extract it from the ovaries. On one trip, Davis worked with a commercial fisherman to set nearly a mile of net. The next day, he dissected 32 females and 36 males. Two of the females were infected, none of the males were, but he had occasionally seen worms associated with the testes. On other trips throughout the year, he processed anywhere from 40 to 60 fish, reporting that the worms grew slowly through the winter, maturing and mating in the spring, and then disintegrating into pieces, with their presumably infective eggs when their host spawns. Fish eggs and worm eggs get flushed out into Lake Texoma together. development of a parasite and host are linked physiologically. We know this fact, a lesson on how the world operates, because of Davis's work. What we don't know yet is how those worms get into buffalo fish, or why they are not found in all the other species of fish in Lake Texoma. How questions are ones involving mechanisms, the way things work, and in general, they are relatively easy to answer unless, of course, it's the one involving the life history of N. texomensis. Why questions are the serious ones. Questions of origin, evolutionary questions. Most scientists concern themselves with how. The answer to why can become as all-consuming, elusive, and ethereal as N. texomensis in a fish's ovaries. In the case of trematodes, those parasitic flatworms we call flukes, how typically involves snails or clams that become infected with larval worms that mature to a certain stage before being released. In some groups, additional hosts such as insects or small fish must acquire these larval worms and then be eaten by a final host before the parasite can become fully mature, mating and spewing hundreds or even thousands of eggs into the environment. Why questions involve evolutionary histories and long time periods during which potential parasites become adapted to live in or on particular hosts, or at sites within a host species' body, or acquire avenues of transmission. These adaptations involve genetically embedded traits that cannot always be recovered by molecular methods, yet can determine not only which host species can and do contain a particular kind of parasite, but also how those parasites are transmitted. Not all flatworms are parasitic. Planarians, commonly used in college biology class animal behavior lab exercises, are free-living examples. The origin of parasitism in flatworms is an evolutionary mystery, but it probably started with worm-snail associations that eventually involved invasion of snail bodies by worms that then proliferated by asexual reproduction. The result, many millions of years later, is that the vast majority of trematodes must reproduce inside snails before continuing their life cycles in a wide variety of insects, crustaceans, fish, and other vertebrates. Snails are also notorious as vectors for parasites that cause some important diseases of humans and domestic livestock. Good examples of such worms are human blood flukes, known as schistosomes, and liver flukes in cattle, sheep, and goats. Human schistosomes infect well over 200 million people globally, destroying their livers and stunting their growth, with up to 700 million at risk in 78 countries. Because larval schistosomes leave their snail intermediate hosts and penetrate skin directly, cultural practices such as rice cultivation contribute to transmission. Domestic animals acquire liver flukes by eating vegetation upon which the parasites have insisted after leaving the snail. Losses due to veterinary infections are in the millions of dollars globally. So regardless of how bizarre N. texomensis was structurally and how different it was from other flukes, Self and his students started trying to solve the life cycle problem by collecting snails. By starting with snails, these scientists were thus behaving like so many of us do when faced with a problem. Try a solution based on what we've already learned from a variety of sources, including parents, friends, school, and the media. In this case, the idea that snails would be a first intermediate host for flukes is a pervasive one, taught in every parasitology course and transmitted through sources with apparent authority, such as textbooks, lectures, and published scientific literature. J. Teague Self didn't need to get infected with an expectation that snails would be the first intermediate hosts for some trematode species. He'd transmitted that idea himself, through his teaching, and had seen the reality of snail-trematode interactions in nature through his own research. Trematode eggs, shed into water, are either eaten by a snail, after which they hatch, burrow through the snail's intestine, and start reproducing in the digestive gland, the snail's equivalent of a liver, or hatch into a larval form that then penetrates the snail before reproducing in the digestive gland. Later larval stages leave the snail and enter another host, sometimes by penetration, sometimes by being eaten, and sometimes by being eaten after having already penetrated another host. Human lung flukes are a good example of this sequence, because people get infected by eating poorly cooked crabs that in turn have been infected with larvae from snails. If human lives seem fraught with risk, trematode lives put that chanciness into perspective, although in a rich and diverse aquatic ecosystem, there are usually enough snails and other small invertebrates to ensure transmission of the species, regardless of how little chance there is that a single worm egg will ever develop into an adult. Self and the others, including both Davis and another grad student named Lewis Peters, who had been caught up in this intellectual trap, focused their work on what they knew about flukes in general, namely that life cycle pattern described earlier. They started snail experiments to discover if what should happen actually did, and of course it did not. Eggs from N. texamensis were plentiful, provided someone collected female fish at certain times of the year. Snails of several different kinds were also plentiful, easily collected, and cooperative enough to stay alive in the lab, sometimes even reproducing. So the lab began the experimental infections. Worm eggs were fed to snails. No infections resulted. Worm eggs were put into water with snails. None hatched into larvae that burrowed into the snails. Someone said what was obvious to all. Maybe we don't have the right kind of snails. Self, Peters, and Davis became snail farmers, collecting and raising every species they could collect from Lake Texoma, the streams that fed into the lake, and local ponds, and feeding them eggs. No infections resulted. The Codex Field Notebook contains page after page of these three scientists' efforts to produce infections in any and every kind of snail or other aquatic invertebrate they could bring into the lab from Lake Texoma, the creeks that drain into it, and ponds that could easily overflow and dump residents into the big lake. All these efforts were failures. It eventually became obvious that none of the common snail species was serving as a required host for the worm's development. In the hands of Self and Peters, the worm could not get past its first embryonic stage. Fish with worms in their ovaries, releasing massive numbers of worm eggs into water, where there were abundant snails of several different species, none of which became infected with this trematode, tells us that the life history of N. texamensis is nothing at all like we expect it to be. That lesson of reality, being the opposite of expectations, gets applied easily to situations far beyond parasites in Lake Texoma fishes. My daily news feed is filled with examples of this lesson at work, especially with respect to some of the hot-button issues of our time: abortion, immigration, racism, and LGBTQ+ rights, all highly complex phenomena, seemingly simplified by their single-word descriptions. Anyone who delves into these issues in detail, especially if driven by a desire to help resolve problems stirred up by political rhetoric, quickly discovers that the reality of individual cases is highly diverse, driven by many different forces, spread across socioeconomic layers, and not nearly as simple as some candidates for public office might want you to believe. Substitute the word textbook for candidates for public office in the previous sentence, and you have a description of the life of N. texamensis. Although molecular biologists have identified some intermediate hosts for related worm species, we still don't have a clear picture of the N. texamensis life cycle, completed with experimental infections. Thus, science has made about as much progress on this parasitological problem as the politicians have made on those much larger ones. Eventually, self's curiosity about the life of this worm evolved into my own curiosity about the life of Clarence Edgar Davis, or at least about the part of it that intersected so mysteriously and briefly with mine. He was a person I had nodded hello to in the halls of that science building, and who was notable because of his job and the color of his skin. Even in the summer of 1960, when I returned to the University of Oklahoma, OU, to pursue my dream of being a college prof, I was experienced enough socially, politically, and biologically to understand the challenges he faced. But that experience was not educational enough for me to do the one thing I wish today I'd been perceptive enough to do, namely, talk to Davis about his life in Louisiana, his reasons for being at OU, and especially his reasons for being employed by Dr. Self. Diaries are notorious sources of historical perspective, and the Self Codex is clearly a special sort of diary. It's impossible to read this set of field notes without constantly being reminded that science is conducted within a social context, which means that the scientists doing their work are also embedded in this cultural environment. That situation has not changed since Davis came to work at the University of Oklahoma, and if anything, the cultural environment has become increasingly difficult to negotiate. Rarely a day goes by that news sources...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.